So, at that time, the two, they succeeded particularly in these two areas. Number one was attracting large-scale funding from national and international donors. Money came from international donors as well. And the second one was that because of this effort of the autonomous women groups, that the government was compelled to co-opt women issues into the development programs. So that was the two issues, but it had a negative side as well. The negative side was that, number one, when money came into the movement, obviously these women groups wanted to have the money and wanted the flow of money to continue. So they, in fact, declared the projects complete even before they were actually complete. So without giving much serious thought into the real implementation of the projects, they declared the project complete because the project had to be completed in a time-bound manner in order to utilize the money and also in order to ensure that future money also flows in. So that is a negative side of that particular impact. Serious thought was not given to actual implementation on the ground of how much the women were actually benefited at the ground level from this. Not much serious thought was given to that. That is one negative aspect of this so-called NGOization of women, women movement. That is one. And secondly, whatever co-option of women issues was made into the development programs of the government, they were mostly at a very superficial, mostly at the declaration level. When it came into the implementation, it did not much change the lot of women or the fate of women or the position of women. And the women organizations were also not very particularly monitoring the government implementation program. They were satisfied if the women issues are co-opted into the program itself. Whether they were actually monitored, whether they are actually implemented or not, this serious monitoring part was lacking in this kind of NGOization of women. So all these, this is a very brief history of the women participation, or women participation in politics, or the history of women movement in India. We divided into three parts: pre-independence, that is 19th century, then during the national struggle, then post-independence struggle, and tried to give a brief summary or brief analysis of the main activities during this period. So with this, I conclude my presentation of the class. Now we can have some interaction. If you have any points to raise or questions to ask, I'll be very happy to respond. Anybody?
Foreign
donor. Why do they get? Yes. Now that's a good question. Then why do they get money from the foreign donors? Particularly, it is not, you know, in foreign countries, or in particularly developed countries in America, Britain, etc., the companies which have become successful, do you know that they allocate a large chunk of their profit for charity purposes? That is what they do. And that is why, you know, you have heard about the Bill Gates Foundation, Melinda and Bill Gates Foundation. They are doing the charity work all over. So obviously for the sake of charity work, they wanted to donate the money to the organizations which are working. Not only women issues, they did not fund only the women issues. Even the case of drivers, for example. Those organizations or those NGOs which are working in the field of drivers, working in the field of health, drinking water, all these activities, they also got large scale funding from the international funds. And let us not also ascribe any motive to that, because many anti-Western friends or any anti-Western scholars, they ascribe motive to it. They consider it as a kind of neo-colonialism by the people of the advanced countries. At least I don't subscribe to this. I have reasons to believe that they have genuine and bona fide intention while funding these programs. It is another matter that if we are not able to utilize it properly, But the funding, I believe, is genuine and full of faith. Anybody else?
Sir, in 1967, what was the Congress monopoly? And why it was challenged?
Congress monopoly in the political field. Because till 1967, it was Congress all over. Central government, Congress, and all state governments by the Congress. It was in 1967 that some of the opposition parties, like we are seeing nowadays, this coalition politics. The coalition politics actually started in 1967. Some of the opposition parties, they formed what is called a Sanjuk Vidhayak Dal. And the Sanjuk Vidhayak Dal, it got majority. And the Congress was in a minority. And in some of the states, this non-Congress government came into power. So that is what I say. But it led to political instability. That is why when I referred to political crisis, I was referring to this political instability. Because of the monopoly of the Congress, it provided a kind of political stability to India. It's not that I support monopoly. I don't support monopoly. I believe that there has to be a very strong and very robust opposition parties. Because without opposition parties, democracy will not succeed. And I believe that even now also, it is time for coalition. But at that time, the Indian people were not very prepared for coalition.
How did it help the women movement?
It did not help any women movement. I was just telling you that the country was in a political and economic crisis, and because of that, large sections of the people, it not only affected women adversely, it affected the students adversely, because unemployment rate was rising. People had education but did not have jobs. Corruption was rising. And health issues. All these things. So farmers' distress, the kind of farmers' distress that we see now, at that time also, it started. So all these, not only the women, the farmers, the youth, the students, all these segments of the people, they are interested.
Sir, after various successful women movements, still women are suffering. What are the reasons behind actually?
No. See, women are suffering not only in India.
Yes.
Women are suffering all over the world. But that does not mean that we should stop the movement.